Please stand as we receive the body of our dear sister, caring Diana Rocksmall. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. It is he who restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest before me a table in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Kindly be seated.
Pleasant good afternoon to every one of you who has made it possible to be here as we celebrate the service, the life of our dear sister Caring Small. I strongly believe that your presence here this afternoon is going to give the members of the family that courage and that strength to go forward. I believe that your coming here today, it is one that is saying, Caring, live a good life. One that is pleasing, that one that was pleasing. And so I believe every one of us present here, we are or we were a friend of Caring. Now, in saying all of this, I am delighted to welcome you into the house of the Lord this afternoon. We are about to have that service on behalf of our dear sister, and I want to say that Caring was a strong lady, number one. Caring, I can remember when we went to anoint Caring. Caring testified about the love of Jesus. Caring was one who made herself ready to meet the Lord. I can testify about it. Because going back on various visits, when we first anointed Caring, that glow that was upon her face, that glory that was shining upon her, every time we went back, That glory is just shining. And I must say that glory is still shining even in this casket. I must say that the funeral service, y'all did a great job for keeping that glory on Karen's face. And so I want to say to all of Karen's children, her mother, friends, relatives, let us not weep as others without any hope. We have this hope that when Jesus Christ is going to come back, I strongly believe, and I guarantee you believe, that we are going to see Karen coming up in the first resurrection. But you and I, we need to be ready to meet Karen. Karen is going to rest. Karen is asleep, as the Bible says right now. And I strongly believe that one of these days, not too far from now, that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is going to burst the eastern sky, and he's going to call all of the dead who die in him to come up, and Karen is going to pop up like popcorn. So as we celebrate, I want us to remember one thing. Revelation 21:4 says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, no more crying, neither shall there be any more pain." Why? The former things are all passed away. So as you hear this evening, sit back and may we all celebrate together what our dear sister left behind before she passed away. And I guarantee you that every one of us will receive a blessing here today. Thank you very much.
At this time, we invite you all to stand as we have our opening hymn, "How Cheering Is the Christian's Hope." How cheering is the Christian's hope, while toiling there below. It buoys us up while passing through this wilderness of woe. It buoys us up while passing through this wilderness of woe. It points us to a land of rest, where saints with Christ will reign, where we shall meet the loved of earth and never part again. Where we shall meet the loved of earth and never part again. A land where sin can never come, temptations ne'er annoy, where happiness will ever dwell, and that without alloy. Where happiness will ever dwell, and that without alloy. In that bright world, no fears will flow. Death ne'er can enter there. For all who gain that heavenly land will be as angels are. For all who gain that heavenly land will be as angels are. Fly, lingering moments, fly, oh fly, dear Savior, quickly come. We long to see, we long to see thee as thou art, and reach that blissful home. We long to see thee as thou art, and reach that blissful home.
Amen. I invite you where you are to bow your heads with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, today we come together to give you thanks for a mother, a friend, a sister, our dear sister, Sister Karen. She loved you unconditionally. She served you with all of her heart. She loved her church and she loved her family. And we are thankful for the impact that she has had on so many persons gathered here, those who are watching online. We thank you for the privilege of knowing her. And though, Lord, this service also reminds us of the pain of this loss, and each person feels it and experiences it in a different way, we have hope that she died trusting in you, believing in you, and one day when you come, she will see you face to face. Lord, for the family who are mourning at this time, the loved ones who are gathered here, we pray that you would draw divinely near to them, comfort them, help them to come to grips with this tragedy, this loss. Lord, you alone know how they are feeling. And you have promised us in your word that there's nothing that we go through that you are incapable of understanding or identifying with us. But your word tells us you were in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. And so we are confident that though we don't know how the family are feeling, that you know and that you care, and you have the remedy to fix the problem of death, and that is the man Christ Jesus. So as we go through this service, may you reassure us. As Pastor Hoyt presents the word of hope, speak through him and bless your people, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
I just wish to make a few brief introductions, after which our program will run unannounced as is printed in your brochure. Officiating with us this afternoon on the platform, on my left, your right, is Elder Elvis Dugois, who served as first elder of the Goodland Seventh-day Adventist Church, where Caring's mother worships. On my right, your left, is Elder George Goddard, who is the current serving first elder of the Goodlands Church. So notice I say that Elder Dugois served, but now Elder George Goddard is the one who is serving as the first elder. Next to him, in the middle, so to speak, is Pastor Shane Butcher, who gave us the opening prayer this afternoon. We also wish to acknowledge the presence of the Honorable Ian Gooding Edgell, who is here with us this afternoon to share in this experience with the family. Please note that because of another engagement that he has, he may take his leave before the service is concluded. I am Pastor Anthony Hoyt, the pastor of the Goodlands Church, and we are thankful and appreciative of the pastor, officers, and members of the Breath of Life Seventh-day Adventist Church for the opportunity where we can have this service of thanksgiving today for our dear sister. I should have mentioned that Pastor Butcher is the pastor of the Government Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church where Sister Kearing held membership. So she was a member of the Government Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Afternoon, church. The first scripture reading is taken from Isaiah 61, chapter 61, verses 1 to 4. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captive, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that they might be glorified. And they shall build the old ways. They shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. Here ends the scripture reading.
Good afternoon to everyone. This afternoon, I'm here to pay tribute to our beloved Kearing with a song that she herself requested entitled The Story I'll Tell, and I pray that you will take from it what she wanted you to receive. Singing, oh.
and options of you. When I can see what you're doing, I know that you're proving you're the God who comes through. Oh, but I know that over the years, I'll look back on this moment, see your hand on it. I know you were here, and I'll testify of the battles you've won. How you were my portion when there wasn't enough. I'll testify of the seas that we've crossed, the waters you've parted, the ways that I've walked. Till all that is left is highest praises, I'll sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. Till all that is left is highest praises, I'll sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. Till all that is left is highest praises, and I'll sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. All that is left is highest praises. I'll sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. Till all that is left, ooh, oh, oh, oh.
Good afternoon, everyone. Strong, brave, resilient, funny, thoughtful, loving, humble, positive, and beautiful are some of the words used to describe Caring by her friends and work colleagues of the RBC Broad Street team. Caring joined RBC Royal Bank in October 2010. During that time, she worked as a service professional with the Broad Street branch. To the outside world, Karen appeared quiet, but those of us who worked closely with her knew this was not always the case. According to her friend Makaida, she was one of the most jovial persons she knew. She loved a good joke and often shared it with a serious face, but soon after, that beautiful smile would appear. Karen performed her role with diligence, and she was never one to complain, even if she faced a particularly challenging client. It should be noted that even though she never complained, it didn't mean we weren't aware when she was annoyed. This was evident when at the end of a transaction and the client left, Karen would give one big stoop and her mouth would be pursed in the air. According to her colleague Rashida, no one could stoop like Karen. Kevin described Karen as a positive light. Even when she faced her private battles, she remained positive, not only a survivor, but a true soldier. Alicia highlighted her caring personality. She often checked on others while she faced her own challenges. I can personally attest to that because last year I went through a season where my mom wasn't well. And when I reached out to Karen, she would ask about her and simply say she's praying for the best. But whenever you asked Karen how she was doing, her response was always, "I good, I all right." Her friend Chernelle further noted that Karen always made her presence known when she arrived at work by coming over to her workstation and giving her a shout. Mikaela said Karen always greeted her with a, "Good morning, gorgeous, beautiful. You look lovely today. Have a fantastic day. Have a fantastic day, love." One thing we all knew about Karen was that she was an exceptional mother. Whenever you wanted to see that big, beautiful smile appear, simply ask about Katrina, Caden, Arcadia. Guaranteed you would get an earful. They were her reason for never giving up, as giving up was never an option, even when life got tough. On behalf of the RBC Royal Bank Barbados, and particularly from the Broad Street branch, I want to extend heartfelt condolences to her mom, Malvina, her children, Katrina, Caden, and Cadia. Thank you for sharing the light that was Karen Small. She will indeed be missed. May she continue to rest in eternal peace. Thank you.
Good afternoon. This is on behalf of me and my siblings. My mom always loved to hear my voice.
Precious love. Good evening. Karen Diana Small, née Rock, was born on April 6, 1976, to Malvina Rock, known to family and friends as Ann and Edrickson Wason. She was the sister of Ricardo Rock and Deshaun Wason. Ann, her mother, described Karen as a sweet and quiet child who was dearly loved by her maternal grandmother. In fact, she remembers that Karen was overdue and would not budge. It was only when Granny Rocky visited the hospital and said, "Ann," that Karen decided, whoosh, it was time to enter the world. And an unshakable bond was formed between the two of them from that day. Karen attended the Eagle Hall Primary School and later the St. Leonard's Girls' School. She was a studious child by all accounts and was always looking out for others. Anne remembers that when Karen was at primary school, she had a friend who lived nearby. One day, the child did not attend school, and Karen decided she wanted to visit her friend to find out why she had been absent that day. Well, Karen and her friend spent the evening playing, and nobody knew where she was. After searching the neighborhoods unsuccessfully for hours, Anne reluctantly went to the police station to report her young daughter missing. As they were returning home, they saw the child's mother walking Karen home. Anne said that she was happy that Karen had learned to care about others from such a young age. And of course, she was relieved to have her daughter home. But Karen's bottom that night reminded her that her actions that day were never to be repeated. A lesson, I am told, was quickly and painfully understood. Now, on the evening of her death, Caden said to me, "Auntie Marcel, all I ever wanted to do was to make my mother proud." As I said to him then, I say to all of you now, Karen was the extremely, and you just heard it from RBC, the extremely proud mother of Katrina, Kadia, and Caden. Karen supported her children in all of their endeavors, whether it was school, athletics, Kadia's artwork, pathfinders, whatever they were involved in, Karen ensured that she was present and active. She was especially proud of their athletic abilities and was a fixture at their various athletic meets, even when she wasn't so well. Now, despite people thinking that Karen was a quiet lady, as her mother described it, when the children were competing, Karen would be doing the dog. As you heard, Karen worked in various government departments before joining the staff of Royal Bank, where she was employed until her death. And as I said, we've already heard about her stewardship in her workplace. On July 14th, 1996, and he starts to smile already, you know, I only call the date and Derek's smiling. Karen married Derek Small. Derek remembers his wife as a cool, loving person and a wonderful mother. He said that she looked after the children's education and athletic achievements and would attend their activities as long as she was able to do so. Derek said that, like all marriages, they had their challenges, but with God at the center, they kept it together, and his love for her never, ever wavered. At the tender age of 46, we can agree with Derek that, as he referred to her, the beauty queen has gone too soon, but she will never be forgotten. Katrina remembers how much her mother loved to hear her sing, and we can understand why, and would always sit down with her on Sabbath evenings to teach her songs. She said that her mom would play the songs over and over, verse by verse, until she knew the song. She also remembers how active her mother was when she, Katrina, was a child, even though, according to her, mommy didn't have an athletic bone in her body. Yet, Karen would always be outside playing games and running around with Katrina and the children in the neighborhood. Katrina says that she will certainly miss the special times she shared with her mom, who was her best friend. Kadia describes her mother as having a beautiful soul, a lady who never wanted her children or anyone to worry about her. In fact, one of Karen's mantras was, "It will work out, what you worrying for?" Kadia recalled that she would be lying next to her mom at night waiting for her to fall asleep. And if her mom made the slightest move or noise, Kadia would say, "Mom, you good?" And the response was always, "Yes, Kadia, go to sleep. I'm good. Rest yourself." Kadia said she knew her mom wasn't good and would usually follow up with, "Mom, you want anything?" To which Karen would always reply, "No, Kadia, I'm all right." For Kadia, her mom was her biggest supporter, who would be cheering more loudly than anyone else at her track meets. She said her mother loved her creations, her art, and everything she did, even if she herself didn't like it. Like Katrina, Kadia acknowledged that her mother was not athletic, but every time they were outside, especially playing cricket, Karen was playing too. And talk about cricket. Kadia said the whole neighborhood knew when mommy was watching cricket on TV. Because as Anne described her enthusiasm, she would be doing the dog. Kaden saw his mother as an energetic lady. He said she would brighten up the room wherever she was. Even when she was sick, he said she was still cracking jokes and laughing. He noted that his mommy always made others smile, and Kadia believes that is how she would want to be remembered, the lady who made others smile. He said that he was grateful she was involved in his life, and that he got to spend the good and the bad times with her up to the very end. Avril's fondest memory of her niece is that Karen used to call her Auntie Abril. And anybody who knows a little Spanish knows that it's Auntie April. And they used to call her Spanish Duck. She said Karen spoke Spanish before she spoke English. To Renee, time spent with her cousin was always the high point of her summer vacation. She even recalls the year when there was a problem with her return flight, and she was so happy to head back to the house from the airport because she saw it as more time and more fun with her cousin. Karen's friend Carolyn said that Karen was like her sister, and she always loved her warmth, her smile, and her encouraging demeanor. One of her favorite Karen stories is about the day Karen was off from work and Karen, Kadia, and Caden spent the day with her. She said that the twins started putting handfuls of dirt in each other's diaper until they were sagging. She said once the diapers were filled, they then started putting the dirt in each other's hair. Well, Karen was in shock. But when she turned to Karen, all she got was, "What do you want me to do? They will learn to work it out." And if you know Katie and Karen, you can hazard a guess who won that fight. Sheen, the mother of the twin, considered Karen to be a sweet and loving person and said she admired the way Karen supported her children. She remembers their chats on the phone and recalls that even down to the last, Karen said she was fine because she just didn't like anyone worrying about her. I couldn't talk to everybody, as you could well imagine, so I'm coming down to the end. Anne Marie and Andrea, two other close friends, spoke of Karen's relationship with God and her children. They said that Karen ensured her children were able to take advantage of the opportunities open to them and also encouraged them to rely on God for any help they needed. According to Andrea, Karen was Bajan to the bone. She loved cuckoo, which was often supplied by her neighbor Roslyn. She loved conkeys and ackies, pawpaws, golden apples, sugar apples, and any local fruit you can think of, Karen loved. Now, as I prepared this eulogy, two things stood out for me. One was Karen's love for God, and two, her love for her family. Her faith was deep and strong, and despite what she was going through, her faith did not waver. Karen never spoke about having an illness, but she always thanked God for her journey. She often remarked that her journey has shown her the love of family and friends, and she hoped that it would be an inspiration to others. The Bible reminds us that we should not sorrow as those who have no hope. I can assure you today that the same God who was with Karen at the beginning of her life was with her throughout her life and was with her at the very end. Karen died with the blessed hope of a resurrection with a glorified body, free from cancer and free from pain. Indeed, I say to you, there is coming a day when no heartache shall come. No more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, what a glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day that will be when Karen's Savior she shall see. When she looks upon his face, the God who saved her by his grace. When God takes Karen by the hand and leads her to the promised land. What a day, what a glorious day that will be. To those of us who are left behind, those who loved her and shall miss her, I say to you, stay faithful. Stay true to the God Karen loved. And in the sweet by and by, we shall all meet on that beautiful shore.
Good afternoon, church. The second scripture reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, reading from verse 13 to 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died, he will rise again. So them which are asleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Here ends the reading.
At this time, we should now have the hymn of reflection and offering. The song that we are going to sing for the hymn of reflection is Just When I Need Him Most. And the offering will be going to offset the funeral expenses of caring.
We will sit and sing. We will sit and sing.
Just when I need Him, Jesus is near. Just when I falter, just when I fear. Ready to help me, ready to cheer. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Jesus is near to comfort and cheer just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him, Jesus is true, never forsaking all the way through, giving for burdens, pleasures anew. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Jesus is near to comfort and cheer just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him, Jesus is strong, bearing my burdens all the day long. For all my sorrow, giving a song. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Jesus is near to comfort and cheer just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him, He is my all, answering when upon Him I call. Lest I should fall. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Just when I need Him most. Jesus is near to comfort and cheer just when I need Him most.
Amen. We are privileged to have Pastor Anthony Hoyt come to share a word of hope. So we invite Pastor Hoyt, who will break that bread of life to all of us today.
Thank you, Pastor Butcher. Let me say good afternoon to those of you who are gathered here today for this service of thanksgiving as we celebrate the life of our sister Caring. I would wish at this time in a public way to express sincerest condolences to her bereaved family, her husband, Derek. I know this is a very difficult and challenging time for you, along with her children, Kadia, Kaden, and Katrina, as well as her dear mom, Sister Malvina. But we are confident that the God whom you serve and the God who caring served is able to keep you. Are you with me? And as we read in the scripture reading, the second scripture reading from the book of 1 Thessalonians, though we understand that it is natural to grieve and to mourn the loss of a loved one, that's human, and we do understand that with our humanity there come certain frailties, but God has promised to wipe away our tears. That day is yet in the future, and we can look forward confidently to it because he who has promised is faithful to his promises. I must confess this evening that I had ample time to prepare for this service. I had given thought to what I will say to those of you who are gathered here today. However, this morning, as I was having my private devotion, reading from the Bible and one of my favorite authors, a lady by the name of Ellen G. White, one who we as Seventh-day Adventists believe to have been inspired of God, as I usually do in the morning, early in the morning, read the Bible and reading from the writings of Ellen White. It was as if the Spirit of God said to me, what I want you to say today to those who are gathered, what I want you to bring as words of comfort and assurance to those who will be gathered here today, is that something better is anticipated. Something better is anticipated. I invite you to reverently bow your heads with me as we pray. Heavenly Father, as I elect to speak to this waiting congregation this afternoon, I pray that you would speak through me. Let my thoughts and my words now give way to your thoughts and your words. And I pray that in this discourse that those who are gathered here physically and those who are viewing online will be blessed, will be strengthened, will be encouraged through the words of hope and assurance that will be shared. I also ask that you will bless the collection, the offering that was given as it will go to the family to assist in defraying the expenses of this funeral service. May it go a long way. And we want to give you thanks and say thanks to the givers. So now let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Something better is anticipated. The key text for consideration is taken from the second epistle of Paul to the church at Corinth, 2 Corinthians, chapter 4, verses 17 and 18. And I read in your hearing. For our light afflictions, which is but for a moment,
worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are seen are eternal. In conversation with his followers, fellow Christians, Jesus said, and it's recorded in the Gospel according to John chapter 16 and verse 33, in the world you shall have tribulation, but in me you shall have peace. In the world, and we are living in the world, Christ declares we will have tribulations, but in him we will find peace. It is important to understand that, and my favorite author puts it this way, that the trials to which Christians are subjected in sorrow, adversity, and reproach are the means appointed of God to separate the chaff from the wheat. Adversity, what is that? Dictionary.com defines adversity as adverse or unfavorable fortune or fate, a condition marked by misfortune, you could say calamity or distress. Does that sound like the situation with the caring, you know? It sure does to me. Or rather, the caring you knew. Then permit me to repeat that statement, inserting her name in it. So I repeat for emphasis. The trials to which caring was subjected in sorrow, adversity, and reproach were the means appointed of God to separate the chaff from the wheat. You see, my dear friends, the Bible speaks of a time in the future when there will be a mass separation. Jesus said it this way, let the wheat and the tares grow together until the time of the harvest. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 30. In Matthew chapter 25 and verse 32, it says, and all nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from the other as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. Now, Jesus was not here speaking of inanimate things. He was talking about a time when the Lord himself would come and there will be a separation made between people. And he likened that separation as to a farmer that is separating the chaff from the wheat, or a shepherd that is separating the sheep from the goats. Adversity is God's appointed agent to prepare his people for that time. My favorite author says God allows affliction to come our way. I know what I'm saying. He does not send it, but he allows it. And if you were to study the life of the biblical character Job, you will discover that. The Bible tells us in Job chapter 1 that there was a day when the sons of God were gathered and Satan himself appeared in the mix. And the Lord asked Satan, "From whence cometh thou?" And his reply was, "From walking to and fro in the earth." And God said unto him, "Hast thou considered my servant Job, that there's none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that fear God and eschew evil?" That, Satan thought, was a good introduction for him to make now, or to launch his appeal and his attack against Job. And so Satan said to the Lord, "Do you believe that Job is serving you for naught, for nothing? I guarantee you that if you would take away the hedge that you have around him, if you would remove the blessings that you have bestowed upon him, then I guarantee you that Job will curse you to your face." The Bible tells us that the Lord allowed Satan to have his way, to cast his attack at Job, but with the understanding that he would not harm him. Are you with me? The Bible says that as Satan went away from the presence of the Lord, he launched such an attack against that man of God, that one who feared God and eschewed evil, in such a way that all that he had, all his earthly possessions, was taken in one day. And Job was a very rich man. The Bible talks about the number of camels that Job had. If it were in today's day, you would say that Job had a fleet of Rolls Royce, because to have a camel that you could ride on was like having a Rolls Royce. He didn't have two or three like Sandy Lane or the plate sandals. He had quite many of them. He was rich in cattle and houses and lands. But all that was taken. And the Bible tells us that Job remained faithful to the Lord. As a matter of fact, Job's testimony was that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, blessed be the name of the Lord. Adversity, God's appointed agent to prepare his children, those who love him, those who look for his appearing, to prepare them for his arrival. And so my favorite author says, God allows affliction to come our way to test and prove us and to show us the defects that exist in our character, which must be overcome if we would experience something better in the future. I say to you, something better is anticipated. Now, I'm not saying that to suggest that there was something wrong with Kerry, but you and I are aware that we are all born in sin and shapen in iniquity. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. When it comes to reflecting the character and the image and the glory of God, we all fall short. And so we are made to understand that the trials that we go through here, the suffering that we experience, that the Lord allows to come our way, he uses as his agents in order to purify us, in order to perfect in us his character, that one day we may dwell with him in glory. Are you listening to me? When these things come our way, it is not because God does not love us. or care about us. As a matter of fact, it is because he loves us that he permits these tests and trials to come our way. Are you listening to me? For in the book of Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 12, the Bible declares, "For the Lord disciplines the ones he loves, as does a father the son in whom he delights." Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 12, the English Standard Version declares, "For the Lord disciplines the ones he loves and chastises every son whom he receives." I can't say that I know what kind of person Karen was before her illness. I only met her after I became the pastor of the Goodland Church where her mother worships. But I do know the person she had become in her illness. For I had the privilege of visiting her and ministering to her. As a matter of fact, on the Friday before she passed, I was there at her home. I spoke with her. She could not speak to me. I had spoken to her before, and she had assured me, and this was weeks before, she had assured me that all was well between her soul and the Savior. I saw in caring no fear of death. And I can tell you that I've looked at many individuals as I've ministered to people as they're lying on their dying beds, and I see the fear of death steering them. Are you listening to me? Sometimes I have to ask the question, are you fearful? But this was not the case with Carrie. She had made peace with her God. And God had given her a peace which the world cannot give and the world cannot take away. That's why Jesus said, in this world, we will have tribulation. In this world, we could expect that we will experience hardships and trials and tests. But if we are anchored in Christ, Christ declares that he will give us of his peace. That's the kind of peace that he was able to bring and give those disciples as they were on the lake, fearful that they were going to experience a watery grave. But Jesus came walking on the water that night and declared to them, "It is I, be not afraid." Then speaking to the elements, he said to the sea and the waves and the wind, "Peace, be still." And I'm saying to us this afternoon that if he can command and the sea and the waves and the wind will obey him, what is man for him not to obey God and experience that peace? As I was saying, I don't know what kind of person she was. Listening to the eulogy, it suggests to me that she was a good person. But I can tell you that in her illness, the Karen I saw and knew was one who was trusting, one who was submissive to the will of God. She was willing to declare like Job, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him." Because she had a faith that was strong in God. Like Job, that a day is coming that even though worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I will see God for myself and not another. She was submissive. She was brave. She was hopeful. She was humble. Afflictions, crosses, temptations, adversity, and our very trials are God's workmen to refine us, sanctify us, and fit us for the heavenly garner. That is to say, the heavenly gathering. Brothers and sisters, friends, there is going to be a gathering. Are you listening to me? And I hope that we are preparing for it, because caring did prepare for that gathering. Believe it or not, this world is God's workshop where he fashions us for the courts of heaven. He uses the planing knife upon our quivering hearts until the roughness and irregularities are removed and we are fitted for our proper place in the heavenly building. Oh yes, it is through tribulations and distress that the Christian becomes purified and strengthened and develops a character like that of his maker and is prepared for the heavenly abode. Remember our key text, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 17 and 18, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I want to say to you this evening, this afternoon, that Sister Kering's afflictions was enormous, but she never complained. She never murmured. Why? Because she kept her eyes fixed not on her pain and suffering. That was temporal. Are you listening to me? Because she is now free of her pains and her sufferings. She kept not her eyes, and her heart was not set on the things of this world. Riches and wealth, fame, position and power, you name it. No, Caring's faith and her heart was set on things not that are temporal and fleeting, are you listening to me? But her faith and her eyes were set on the things that are eternal. And that is what gave her the momentum and the strength to keep pressing on until the Lord decided to give her rest from her labors. And the word of God tells us in the book of Revelation chapter 14 and verse 13, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors and their works do follow them. I'm saying to us this afternoon that something better is anticipated. You see, the things of this world are temporal, are fleeting. If Michael Jackson was alive, you could ask him, King of Pop. He had lots of money, but it was reported he had at least $400 million in debt when he died unexpectedly in 2009. Fleeting. Today you have, tomorrow you don't. Mike Tyson, boxing sensation. It is estimated that he earned over $400 million in his career as a boxer, but he was knocked down in 2003 with a $23 million debt. Wealth and riches, popularity and fame, it only lasts for a time. That's why the Bible encourages us not to set our affections on the things of earth, because the things of earth will pass away. I've mentioned two men, but women suffer the same fate too. They are not excluded. We read of Pamela Anderson, the celebrity who enjoyed luxurious houses and costly celebrations, who had many medical plastic procedures. Anderson, who accumulated some $35 million, was one of Hollywood's greatest centerfold girls. She ended up living in a trailer park, became one of America's celebrity homeless. Why? Because the things of this world will pass away. They are fleeting. And it was Lisa Presley. And I can go on and on, but I'll just give you this last one. Lisa Presley, the charming daughter of Elvis Presley, king of rock music. Lisa had never been shy or short of money as a youth. She was accustomed to flying in luxury planes and the life that goes with it. But after a nasty separation from one Michael Lockwood, she was left with a $16 million debt. And we can go on and on. I'm saying to us this evening that what the world offers is fleeting in comparison to what God has in store for his children. That is eternal. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. The apostle Paul, who had given up everything to serve the Lord Jesus Christ, writes, "But as it is written, I have not seen, ear have not heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man the things which God have prepared for them that love him." We're talking here about the things that are eternal. Jesus said, "I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also." John, the beloved disciple who was banished to the island of Patmos for his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, was given a sneak preview, if you please, of that place that the Lord has gone to prepare for them that love him. And so John recorded in the book of Revelation chapter 14, Revelation chapter 14 verses 1 through to 4, John declares, having seen a slight bit of what God has in store for those that love him, he says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God." But it gets better. Verse 4 says, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death." You hear that, Derek? Melvina? No more death. Neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. John was given a preview of what the future holds for those who love the Lord and look for his appearing. So you may ask me this afternoon, well, when will all that take place. Well, Paul tells us in our scripture reading this evening in the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Paul says to us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, beginning at verse 13, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren." Paul was not speaking like a Bajan, you know, because when Bajans speak of ignorant, we talk about foolish people. So we say, "Don't, that man is an ignorant man," meaning that man is a crazy man. Don't mess around. What Paul was there saying is that I don't wish you to be without knowledge, to be uninformed. That's what he was saying. "Concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope." What sleep is Paul talking about? Paul is not talking about the sleep that one takes in the night with the hope of waking in the morning. Oh no, he's speaking about the sleep of death. Because I'm sure that none of you, when you say goodnight to your spouse, your loved one, the person who you're sleeping next to in the bed, or the children in your house, and you say goodnight to them, "I'll see you in the morning," you don't sorrow over them. Paul is here speaking about the sleep of death. And so he says, "I would not have you to be uninformed concerning those who are asleep, who are dead in Christ. Do not sorrow, even as others who have no hope." If you don't know Christ, you don't have a hope of eternal life. But I want to declare to you this evening that if you today would give your life to Jesus, if you've not done so before, you can have the hope and the assurance of eternal life. For the Bible tells us in John chapter 3 and verse 16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Paul continues in this passage in verse 14. He says, "For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him." Do you believe that Jesus died and rose from the dead? I know some of you may be thinking, "I don't believe." And I would say to you, well, if you don't believe, in the next couple of Fridays, don't take the day off. But if you believe that Jesus died, then also believe that he rose again. That's why in the Christian world, we celebrate, you celebrate Good Friday and Easter Sunday in celebration of the death of Jesus Christ and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Are you there with me? And Paul declares, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that those who sleep in Jesus, God is going to bring with him. Now, let me clear up something here for you before I take my seat. This is not to suggest that the dead are now in heaven with the Lord. And you're going to see that in a moment. Because there are many teachers who are going about teaching that when one dies, such as our dear sister Kiering, that she is now in a better place. She is in heaven. But that's not what the Bible teaches. So Paul says, For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep, such as Sister Kiering, God will bring with him. Jesus is coming back again. Verse 15, Paul is going to explain himself. "For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep." Now, Again, the King James Version does not give us a good translation there. That word prevent is better translated as precede. And you will understand as I continue. So Paul is saying that those who are alive to witness the coming of the Lord will not precede, will not receive their eternal inheritance before those who go to their grave. Let's look at verse 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. Where is he coming from? From heaven, the Bible says. He's coming with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Now, if the dead in Christ are going to rise, when Jesus comes in the clouds with the shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, they can't be in their grave and still be in heaven. So there's going to be a resurrection of the dead. That's what Paul is saying tonight. And at that resurrection, those who die in Christ will be raised to life. Verse 17, he says, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up with them together in the clouds. That is why I say the better translation for prevent is precede, that is to go before. You see, some are not going before others. Those who die have not gone before those of us who are alive to receive their reward. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them, those who are raised from their graves, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. There's coming a day when those like Sister Kieran who have died believing in Jesus, believing in the resurrection, accepting the death of Jesus Christ as the atoning sacrifice for her sins, will hear the voice of the life giver and will be raised to eternal life. Wherever they are laid in cemeteries across the world, those graves will open up. Those who have gone to watery graves in the sea will give up. Those who were eaten by sharks and large fish will be brought back together. Don't ask me how God is going to do it. If God could create a world from nothing, ex nihilo, he can make something, he can bring back something from nothing that he created before. He is God. And he says that he will do it. And this is the hope that we have as Christians. This is the hope that Kieran lived with and died with, a hope of a resurrection in Jesus Christ. There is going to be a reunion. You didn't hear what I said. I said there is going to be a reunion. I see you all gathered here this afternoon to pay your last respects, to stand in solidarity with the family at this time in their moments of grief and sorrow. But hey, I've come to let you know that the family has planned for them a reunion, and you better make sure that you prepare yourself for it, to be there. Are you listening to me? I don't know about you, but I love reunions. You hear what I say? I love reunions. Man, at reunions, I see the folk come out in all their fancy uniforms, you know? They go and they spend money to print shirts, just like how nicely attired our folk here from Royal Bank of Canada is attired. They print nice shirts to identify one with the other. Yeah? One with the other. They bring out the nice dishes, nice food. They have nice fellowship. They play games together and have nice fun. Are you listening to me? I love reunions. But the problem with the reunions down here, because we are living in this world, is that they are temporal. They pass away. After a few days or weeks, you hear people declaring, I've got to get back to my job. Maybe they're fleeing from abroad. You hear some people say, well, you know, I left my dog with the neighbor, and I have to go and get it. Yeah, some people love their dog. Boy, you would not believe. Some people leave their inheritance for their animals, house and land, etc. Their wealth for their animals. Some people will tell you, I've got to get back to my goldfish or my cat or my dog. They make all kinds of excuses why they must go. But the thing about this reunion is that there will be no parting again. We will be together forever. It will be a reunion that will last forever and ever and ever. Amen. You know what that means? So let it be. That is what amen means. So let it be. It will be forever and ever and ever. Somebody could say amen. I am looking forward to that. Caring looked forward to, lived with that hope and desire. And she died with that hope and that desire. And I want to let you know that our God will not disappoint her. He who has promised will come and will not tarry. And the dead will be raised. Those who are alive in Christ will be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And the Bible says, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Today I say to the bereaved family, be comforted. Not in the words of the preacher, but in the words of God. Because you see, the words of man are fleeting, like ropes made of sand. But the word of the Lord endures forever. May you be comforted in knowing that your loved one died in Christ, and that when he who is our life shall appear, they shall be with him to live and to dwell with him throughout the limitless ages of eternity. May each and every one of us plan to be there when Jesus comes.
We thank God for using Pastor Hoyt to bless our hearts, and we thank God for the message of hope. We are now going to stand and make use of our final hymn, Never Part Again. There is a land of pure delight where bliss eternal reigns. Infinite day excludes the night, and the pleasures banish pain. Traveling to Emmanuel's land, we soon shall hear, and soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. What? Never part again? No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again.
their everlasting spring abides, and never withering flowers. Little space divides this heavenly land from ours. We are traveling to Emmanuel's land. We soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign and never, never part again. Could we but stand where Moses stood and view the landscape o'er, not all this world's pretended good. Good. We are traveling to Emmanuel's land. We soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign and never, never part again.
Amen. Please remain standing. We'll have a word of thanks from Roseanne Maxwell, and this will be followed by benediction by Elder Elvis Dubois.
Good evening, everyone. I could not start this thank you this evening without giving thanks to Pastor Hope for his inspiring message this evening on adversity. Thank you, sir. I've been tasked this evening with the responsibility of delivering the thank you on behalf of the family. Our thanks go out to those of you who visited the family on March 6th after learning of Karen's passing, to those of you who sent cards, called, visited, and prayed during the difficult periods leading up to this evening, to Roseanne Warner, who stood by Anne's side at every back and call, and when Anne needed assistance with Karen, and also Marcel Bess, our eulogist this evening. Selma Lynch, who was Karen's go-to and who would always come over to stay with her, even at short notice. We also want to take this opportunity to express our thanks to you here this evening, as well as our online audience, as we celebrate the life of Karen and her homegoing service. Thanks especially to the RBC family, the Quantum Leap Athletic Club family, the church families of the Government Hill SDA and Goodland SDA Church, Spira Academy, and the Alexander School family, to list a few. The numbers here and online this evening is an indication of the lives that Karen has touched during her lifetime. Thanks to the pastor and the team of the Breath of Life SDA Church and Downs and Wilson Funeral Home for their care and dedication at a time when it was most needed. As I close, I ask you to continue to keep the family in your prayers, especially Karen's parents, Anne and L. Dirksen, her husband Derek, or Ricardo as you may know him, her children Katrina, Kadia, and Kaden, as they navigate the void or the new normal that has been created in their lives with the memories forever in their hearts. So on behalf of The Rock, Small, Phillips, Cumberbatch, Bess, and Sobers family, we express our heartfelt thanks and appreciation this evening. Thank you.
Let us pray. Father in heaven, we give you thanks, dear God, for your Holy Spirit who has led that way. We thank thee, dear Father, for everyone who came up here to do their part. They did it in the right way. We thank thee, dear God, for your word which uttered from your manservant. One that can remind us that Jesus Christ is coming soon. One that can tell us that every one of us have to prepare to meet the Lord when he shall come. We thank thee for the life that caring live, whereby, dear God, it could have bring much impression upon the hearts of other people. And so we pray, oh God, that when that glorious reunion day shall come, when all of God's children will gather together to meet the Lord in the air, that every one of us present here will be able to meet you in the air. This is your will. This is our will. We are looking forward for that day. We pray that as we are about to leave here, to go to our various directions, we pray that you are going to take us even to the burying ground in safety. We don't want to leave without presenting the Rock family and the Small family into your hand. We pray that you are going to comfort them, strengthen them, protect them, help them to understand that they are not in it alone. When Jesus is in the vessel, they can smile at the storms. So strengthen them, give them that wonderful hope of assurance that they will be able to see caring once again when all of God's children will gather together in that beautiful mansion that you have gone to prepare for us. We thank you for hearing, listening, and answering our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let me say good afternoon again as we gather here at the Westbury Cemetery for the committal of the body of our sister, Sister Caring Small. Shall we bow our heads for word of prayer? Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for your kindness and your mercies, your blessings towards us. We thank you for bringing us, Lord, safely to this place where we commit our sister to her final resting place before Jesus shall return. May you grant us now the presence of your Holy Spirit and your holy angels to minister to those who have gathered here who grieve. And may we feel the sweet presence of your Spirit with us as we go through this phase of the service. We ask for Christ's sake. Amen. I read in your hearing from the writings of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning at verse 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. For as much as God in his infinite wisdom and mercy have permitted at this time our dear sister Caring Diana Small to lay down the burdens, the worries, the pains, the sorrows, the sufferings of this earthly life, we do tenderly commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. We do so in a certain and joyful hope of a resurrection with our Lord when he shall come, when this corruptible body of ours shall put on incorruption, and this mortal body shall be changed into an immortal body like to that of Christ at his resurrection. Until then, may she rest in Jesus and rise to meet him in glory on resurrection morning. Amen. This we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Seems like only yesterday that your laughter filled the air, and whatever I was going through, you were always there. How you gave of all your love and time to those who were in my heart, you'll always be a part of me. Though sometimes it's hard to deal with you not being here, rejoice that you have reached that place of peace where there's no fear. Heaven has become a little sweeter just because you're there, and we'll meet again in that place so bright and fair.
we sing the hymn, Shall We Gather at the River, where bright angels' feet have trod, with its crystal tide forever flowing by the throne of God. Faithfulness, O God my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not, as thou hast been, thou forever.
Thank you.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. That exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the lamb of the blood was spilt. Grace, grace, God's grace.
Thank you.
The Word of God declares in the book of Revelation, chapter 22, "And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the midst of the street of it, and on either side of the river was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruits, and yielded her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. And his servants shall serve him, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there. And they need no candle, neither light of the sun, for the Lord God giveth them light. For the Lord God giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. And he said unto me, These things are faithful and true. And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servant the things which must shortly be done. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. And I, John, saw these things and heard them. And when I had heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things. Then saith he unto me, See, thou doest it not. For I am of thy brethren the prophets, and of them which keep the sayings of the book, worship God. He saith unto me, Seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according as his work shall be. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city.
Peace eternal. Christ has a boy passing through this wilderness of war. Points us to a land of rest, where sins with pride will reign, where we shall meet, where we shall meet the love of earth. Shall meet the love of earth and never part again. Where sin can never come, temptation never know. Where happiness will ever dwell, and not without the Lord. When happiness will ever dwell, and not without the Lord.
As we bring this service to a close this afternoon, we will have the benediction. Please bow your heads with me as we pray. Our Father and our God, we come to you once at the conclusion of this service of thanksgiving today for the life of our dear sister, Carrie. Once again, we express our thanks and our gratitude to you for your kindness, your mercies, blessings towards us and towards her. We know that it was never part of your plan that we should die. But sin entered into the picture, and the Bible tells us, whereas by one man sin entered into the world, and so death by sin, and so death reigned upon all men. But we are thankful that the text does not stop there. It goes on to say that through one man, Jesus Christ, all who believe on him, all who accept his sacrifice on Calvary, will have life. And so it is with this hope, this assurance, that we come, we say thank you for the life that you have promised to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray this evening for the family of Sister Kearing. Her husband, once again, we lift before you, Derek, her mother, Melvina, her children. We pray that you would remain near and dear to them. Their mom, their daughter, went to sleep with the blessed assurance that Jesus will come again. Amen. And will raise to life those who now sleep in him. May they also embrace that hope. May they also accept the salvation which she herself accepted many years ago. And may they look forward to the time when you will come and you will reunite them again. But until then, we pray that you would be with them. We pray that you will shelter them under your arms. We pray that you will provide for them and that they would live with the hope of being reunited. We pray today that the attending angel which you did commission to the side of your daughter Kieran at her birth, her entrance into this world, will now mark this very spot where we lay her body. And on the resurrection morning, when the dead in Christ shall arise, may that same angel have the privilege of escorting her into your presence to hear from your lips, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that I have prepared for you from the foundation of the world." And so, may the Lord bless those of us who remain and keep us. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon us and grant us his peace. Peace now and peace forevermore, until we shall see Jesus for ourselves, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Once again, I want to take the opportunity to thank all of you who attended this homegoing service for Karen. We ask you to continue to keep the children and her husband and her parents in your prayers, as we know it's going to be a difficult time. So thank you so much. May God continue to keep each and every one of us as we go through this difficult period. Thank you so much.